Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 122 of the RRBG podcast. Please check out the Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/RRBG and sign up today to support the podcast. You can get access to exclusive interviews that I did at Psycho Las Vegas, get yourself a t-shirt, and we could use all the help we can get as we try and take the podcast on the road. So go to patreon.com/RRBG and sign up today to support the podcast. We really do appreciate your help. In this episode, I talked to Dan Briggs of the band Between the Buried and Me. I've been a big fan of the band for a long time, so it was a real honor having him on the show. We talked a little bit about the lifestyle that it is to be in a band like that and traveling nonstop. We talk about his solo project, Nightmare Scenario, which has an EP out right now, and he's working on the full length. We talked a little bit about baseball. We talked a little bit about veganism. It was a great conversation, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Please don't forget to check him out online, at Dan Briggs X on Twitter, and at Dan Briggs Music on Instagram. And keep an eye out for the Between the Bear and Me tour coming to North America with Chon and Intervals. The dates are available now on their website. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And if you get a chance, go to Apple Music and leave us a review. Those really do make a difference. Cheers. And welcome to the RRBG podcast. I'm here with Dan Briggs of the band Between the Buried and Me. How are you doing today?
I'm good.
You're also in a bunch of other bands. It's not just Between the Buried and Me, but you've got Orbs, you've got the Trioscapes, you've got Nova Collective, and you've got the solo Nightmare Scenario.
That's true. Yeah. I've always kind of viewed it as like I'm kind of a ball of creative energy, and when someone drops something in front of me, it kind of like, you know, it's like a spark to gasoline or something. You know, it just sets it off. So like, you know, Orbs was kind of born out of that, Trioscapes, Nova Collective, and then you know, Nightmare is Nightmare. Funny enough, started years ago, and I've had a full length written for years, but I'm just this year getting around to recording it. It's a big undertaking, so I've just kind of over the last year kind of been recording and releasing some stuff on my own, just to kind of get the thing out there, get the idea out there of Nightmare Scenario, but also you know, it's given me an opportunity to work on things like my voice and just recording and production stuff. It's fun. It's a whole different, it feels like a whole different side of my brain in a way. But of course it's the same, you know, kind of creative thing that I've been doing for years.
For sure. I mean, it's always fun to experiment with music, and especially trying out new things like singing, cause mostly you play bass. Yep. and keyboards and stuff like that. But you know, experimenting with vocals is always fun, and I, you know, I heard a track that you have online right now for Nightmare Scenario, and I gotta say, I got this really cool, like, moody, electronic, almost, there was a vibe of 80s, like, King Crimson. you know, when they kind of changed their sound a bit from like the more of prog metal to kind of a more 80s synthy, like the Three of a Perfect Pair kind of era.
Yeah. There's kind of no one defining characteristic of the Nightmare stuff, but you might have heard maybe Earth Below or something that might be the track that you're talking about.
Ah, okay. So the different tracks have different sounds?
Yeah, kind of, yeah. I have so many different groups and so many different outlets because there's just a lot of different stuff and a lot of different sounds that go into the Briggs machine, and a Nightmare's kind of just an extension of that.
Is that something you plan on recording with Jamie? By the way, shout out to Jamie for setting this up for us too. You know, he's just the best. yeah, I had him on the podcast, and he also mixed and mastered my band's album. So he's always just been a really great guy.
Oh, he stays so busy, man. It really does. It's crazy because, you know, we show up at his place every 3 years or so, whatever, to do a new record, and we always just kind of forget that he just keeps going after that. Tommy's more involved with, you know, helping Jamie schedule his stuff or whatever, but the rest of us, you know, it's just, and it's he's always kind of on call and on hand when, you know, when I've had questions or need to record something fast or mix something, and you know, he's always down to get you in, which is great.
Yeah. So the initial question was, do you plan on recording the full length with him, or are you going to do it yourself?
No, I think there's things I'll be able to do myself. I'll definitely feel, even though I'm so comfortable after 15 years or so of working with Jamie, I'll still would feel most confident doing at least my vocal stuff at home. There's definitely a lot that I would like to do with Jamie, and it's something where the reason why I've kind of been putting it off a little bit is because there's going to be a lot of different recordings and different performances and different spaces, and honestly different locations. I'm going to have to travel a bit to track people down and record, and that's, it's going to be fun. It's just I just haven't fucking planned it out yet. I have one vocal demo to finish, and I've almost kind of, I feel like not purposefully been putting it off because then it's going to be real and I have to, you know,
get it moving.
But in the meantime, I keep kind of like distracting myself and everyone else by just releasing other stuff.
Well, I mean, you know, I wouldn't really call it distracting. You have, there is kind of, I guess, I don't want to call it an obligation, but I mean, The Between the Bear to Me is, it's a machine, you know, like you guys are very well known. You're constantly touring, constantly putting out double albums, which I just don't understand how you guys write so much music. It blows my mind. And then to hear that you have like three other projects and you're trying to get a solo project out, it's nuts. Like, how do you manage your time like that? You know, and like you said, you feel that you're putting it off, but I just think it's a matter of, you just got a lot going on, you know?
It is, and it's hard. Yeah. No, it's, you know, when I'm home, you know, standard day for me is, you know, I'm up in my office from maybe 11 or 12 until, you know, 6 or 7 at night. And it's either just hashing through new ideas or you know, working on stuff that's, you know, been saved from, you know, a couple months ago from, you know, before we went on a tour or whatever mind space I was in. And, you know, as far as something like, generally with, I feel like with an album, whatever I'm working on with the band is trying to capture what's going on in that moment. Mm. I feel like that's been the best way to do it and kind of the most honest way kind of doing it. So it's not like you're fishing through old ideas, past ideas. Like I'm not into that. I just, you know, that there's no shortage. So it's every couple of years when it's time to do a new BTBAM, you know, I'm generally have done so much in between that time that it's kind of like, okay, well, where am I at now? You know, what have I learned now? And, you know, getting to play with so many different musicians and write with so many different musicians, I always learn a lot and have a lot of takeaways that, you know, go back into influencing everything else.
For sure, for sure. And, you know, I wanted to bring this up. The you mentioned that you have to travel and you have all these different scenarios for the nightmare, nightmare scenario. It kind of fits the name, you know, if you think about it.
Like, yeah.
For a producer, that is a nightmare scenario, having to have different sounds, different rooms, different mics, all that is kind of scary for a producer, but it might actually just fit into the whole theme, you know?
It might, yeah. It's, it's just a lot. Instrumentation is pretty crazy, and it's not like anything that I've released yet. And it's kind of funny because it's the first stuff that I started writing on my own.
Nice.
it's pretty out there.
Now, I recently found out you're 34.
Yeah.
Dude, so, and you've been with BTBAM for 15 years. So you started what, when you were 20 with them?
Yeah.
And when did you start music? Because, like, just not, and not that you look old, but when I see what you've done and when I see the legacy you've built with the band and all the things you've produced and everything, it feels like you would have, you know, you would have been in your 40s or something. Like, and it blows my mind that you're so young and you've already kind of established yourself as kind of like a prog metal legend. You know, people respect the band on that level. And, you know, when did you start and what got you into bass and getting into prog metal and all that?
Well, you know, my mom was a music teacher and my dad was, you know, just really into music. I felt like I was just kind of doomed at an early age. And, I started playing guitar when I was maybe 10, and I started playing bass a couple years later when middle school started up. And I had wanted to be in, you know, the concert band and the jazz band. And so I was doing bass for that. And in like the concert band, I was reading, you know, like trombone parts and transposing tuba parts. And then a couple years later in high school, I started playing the upright bass in orchestra. And that's actually what I went to school for, to college for. And then, you know, all, you know, from the time I was 12 or whatever, I was, you know, I had bands all the way, almost a different band every year, you know, on guitar or bass, until I left Pennsylvania when I was 20, you know, so I was probably in 7 or 8 different bands, before I moved and started the last chapter of, you know, the last 14 years or whatever. So it was, yeah, it's just a lot of,
Well, it started from an early age, you know.
From an early age, yeah, and I just, you know, as you are as a kid, teenager, high school, college, whatever, you know, you're like a sponge, you know, and whatever you hear, whatever new thing you hear is like the most exciting thing you've heard, and so you know, when I was in high school and started getting into stuff like Dream Theater and Yes, King Crimson, it was, you know, all these influences that I'd been into, it started been, had, were kind of coming together into one thing, you know, where it was like, you know, classical music that I was playing, the jazz that we'd been studying, all this stuff, you know, Odd Time Signatures was all kind of coming together into this music and then into, you know, fusion and Zappa and stuff like that I was getting into in college. And, you know, it was like kind of like there was an outlet for everything my brain was taking in to kind of channel into the one thing. And, you know, it's an exploratory, genre of music. It bums me out in recent years as it's kind of gotten thrown around as kind of like, you know, like an industry tag word, for clumping a group of music together that, you know, isn't always forward thinking and different. And for, you know, to me, that's what attracted me to it, you know, was, these bands and these artists that sounded nothing like anything that I'd been listening to and nothing I'd heard before. So.
Yeah. It's funny how people always want to put a label on something like that. And, you know, because when I first heard Between the Buried and Me, my friends were listening to it and I never had heard it. And they were like, oh, it's death metal. And I'm like, I don't really like death metal.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to check that out. At the time, I'm into it now. But, and it's actually you guys. You actually got me into death metal. So,
I'm not a death metal guy. So it's like, there's been a constant kind of pool over the years and a natural progression of the band, you know, evolving, you know what I mean? So like we're doing this fucking 2-hour set evening with thing in Europe and it's like real, like retrospective and going way back. And, I haven't started learning songs yet, but it's like, you know, it's, you know, stuff that goes back to before me and Dusty and Blake were in the band. And
Okay.
And it's just like, man, there's like these little ties to like now, but you know, it's really, it's the almost 20-year journey, you know, of getting to where the band is now.
Yeah, because the sound is completely different now to not, I wouldn't say completely, but you listen to early like Silent Circus stuff and it's a lot more straight. Like there's a lot of blast beats and really low growls and kind of very aggressive and fast. And,
right.
You know, there were hints of those pauses of like, you know, there's a little pretty solo or a pretty singing part here and there.
Right.
And that's actually what got me into it. Cause you know, straight up death metal to me at the time was kind of like, it's just like white noise. Like it's static. And there wasn't really much for me to grab onto. But when I started hearing those little hooks here and there, I was like, oh, okay, there's more to it. And then you guys evolved your sound every album. Just I felt like it kind of you added more elements and more, you know, soundscapes and progression to the chords and everything.
Yeah, and part of that turn, you know, with Alaska and then really with Colors was just adding these new pieces in and everyone getting comfortable, you know. We kind of, I wrote a big essay and kind of, you know, documented looking back at the period of Colors when we did the anniversary tour a couple years ago, and it really was kind of at that point, you know, us settling in after writing and touring together for a couple years, being more comfortable and then just really like pushing, you know, really trying to push into some new territory at the time. You know, and now that territory is not new. Now, you know, in 2019, 20, whatever, whenever we write next, you know, next year or something, you know, the goal is not to sound like 2007, you know, it's, the ways in which we're pushing have to be different. So,
yeah, it's funny. And, you know, death metal fans can be kind of elitist and, you know, they hate on the fact that you guys, you know, introduce singing or whatever. And it's just like, you know, as you get older, things change and your tastes change. You're not as aggressive as you were when you were younger. You're not as angry and angsty, like an angsty teenager. You know, you're not mad at your parents and all that stuff that kind of draws you into that world. And, you know, it's a bummer when I hear dudes like, oh yeah, you know, I don't listen to them anymore. I only listen to Silent Circus or whatever it is. Like, I think, guys, you know, just give it a shot. Cause one of the things that appealed to me most, was that element that you mentioned, like working as a concert musician or like orchestra or symphony, you know, classical music. Because I grew up as a huge nerd, like listening. I was the only kid in my high school with exception of my buddy who I would drag into my room to listen to it. But we would sit there and just listen to, you know, Mozart stuff and you know, classical soundtracks. Like my favorite was like Star Wars soundtrack. Like we would sit there and listen to John Williams stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, all my other friends were like, oh, check out Korn. I'm like, cool, that's great. But also, check this out. And, it's really interesting to me that people can't separate, they can't break off the distortion or whatever. Like when I tell them, hey, listen to BTBAM, it's like classical music. They're like, no, what are you talking about? It's heavy metal or whatever. It's death metal. I won't, you know, I won't open up to that. And it's just, I don't know.
Well, that's like even, you know, you know, listening to some of the 70s, like, King Crimson stuff, it's so clearly influenced by, like, Stravinsky or something. And it's like, you know, that sound, that influence is, it's totally there. It's just channeled in, you know, in a different way. And I think that's, you know, even, you know, I feel like bands, when you wear your influence on your sleeves, you know, it's kind of channeled through you and through your voice and what your output is. So it's always going to be a little different, you know?
Sure. Yeah. And the type of music you guys are writing, I know you are specifically, you're straight edge and you have you're very vocal about your vegan lifestyle. And do you feel that that's kind of needed for the type of input, or I'm sorry, the type of output that you're putting? Just, you need that clarity of mind, that, because some people associate your music, like I personally would have associated colors with psychedelics, you know what I mean? Because it's so trippy, you know what I mean?
Heard that a lot, yeah. We've had a lot of people ask us about that, or tell us about, you know, the drugs they use listening to the records. And really, you know, there's, you know, Dusty's the only member of the band who, you know, smokes weed. You know, Blake might have an edible every now and then in Colorado. But, you know, Tommy and Paul have never drank or smoked or done drugs. And we're not, it's like, you know, I'm not vocally straight edge, but like I am, you know what I mean? It's sure. Like a, you know, it was really great when I was in high school and, you know, you're kind of searching for identity, you're searching for your crowd. And it was really comforting to have, you know, people who were, you know, just, you were just focused on music, you know, and got lost in, you know, the bands at that time that had sort of a message. And it was great. It's just as time went on, you know, it just became a part of your life. You know, you're just, you know, I just don't do that sort of thing, you know, whatever. Yeah. And, you know, for me, you know, like I'm sure with everyone, you know, I mean, I've seen people struggle with addiction, you know, different kinds, and it's fucking, it's crippling, you know, you know, it's, you know, even recently I've gone through it with someone, and it's just fucking sad, you know, when you see people who, you know, have such great potential, and I don't think that's like, you know, that not partaking in anything is, it has any sort of direct correlation to, you know, my creative output or whatever. But it's, I don't know. I try to, I don't know. I try to keep as clear and open of a mind, you know, with everything, you know, as far as, when it's time for the creative output and the creative flow. So I've, you know, I've never tried to muddy that up.
For sure. And I mean, I know there's people that it enhances them, but there's a lot of people where it just, like you said, it cripples them. It makes it more difficult. You know, me when I was in a band, the band I was with that I told you Jamie produced, or not produced, but mixed and mastered. But, you know, during that time period, I was like really doing a lot of drinking and doing a lot of pretty much whatever I can come by, you know, and it wasn't really all that beneficial. Like the writing was, it felt fun because we were experimenting with different things, but I noticed looking back at videos of like our performances and stuff like that, that I just, you know, I was like, I wish I was a little more clear on that. You know what I mean? Not so intoxicated at that time. And, yeah, it's crazy. And, you know, I applaud you for not falling into, the pressures of, you know, high school or whatever to fit in, or, you know, like, hey, let me try that. Or, you know, it's, you focused all of your energy into music, thankfully, you know, since you had that growing up with your parents. That's, like, you know.
Yeah, it's funny though, because I love all the, like, like everything else associated with it. Like I, you know, I love, you know, trippy, far out, bizarro movies and music and artwork. Like, you know, I'm totally into it. I just never got into it on my own, I guess, you know?
Sure, yeah. And one of the things I wanted to talk to you about, like you guys in Between the Bear and Me have a lot of the psychedelic type of, not psychedelic, let me rephrase that, kind of an existential, spiritual, like the video you guys put out for Astral Body.
Mm.
Like that video spoke very deeply to me because it's something that I experienced. One, when I had my, I had a very deadly car accident back in 2002, cool. And I saw some crazy stuff, very similar to what's in the video. And, and then also kind of revisited it when I was after the accident, I wanted to explore that realm and just kind of figure out what it was that I saw. And that's kind of when I started experimenting with psychedelics to see.
Right.
What it was. And it wasn't like a, you know, I wasn't like a junkie, like, oh, I need drugs. It was like, I just wanted to know what I saw. And a lot of people pointed me in that direction.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I love that. Yeah. Our drummer's brother did that video. He's like insanely talented. It's still my favorite video that we've done. And I think it's one of the coolest visual things associated with the band for sure. It blew my mind when I saw it.
So in since you are, you know, like you said, you don't experiment with that type of stuff, but you are attracted to that realm. Like, have you had any kind of experiences like that? Is that something you are connected to where you've had these out-of-body type of experiences?
Not really, but I was, you know, I was reading a book about astral projections at the time, and that's where there's a spoken word on that album, and some of the dialogue from it, I lifted from passages in the book. And Tommy initially had a different name for Astral Body. And then, you know, I think kind of referenced that speech, you know, what was going on there and applied it to the song. But no, I never have. I think that I'm really aware of. I mean, I think there's situations, you know, where I am, you know, where you remove yourself from and you feel like you're seeing them from a different vantage point. But I've never had like a, you know, a true astral projection. But I was just very curious. I think I found it at a thrift store and wanted to flip through and see what it was all about.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I mean, people tend to kind of fantasize about what the meaning is behind some of those things. Like you guys have sort of that allure, bands like Tool too, where the fans take it to this whole new level. Like, oh, there's some very deep meaning in that. And you know, like you listen to songs from Tool, they're like, oh, Hooker with a Penis is about something very deep. And it's like, they could just be about a hooker with a penis too.
Yeah. You never know with Maynard what's going on. It's funny because I think at the core, you know, not to just get off talking about Tool, but, you know, I think that they're actually, they come off with a very serious demeanor, and I think they're actually probably pretty funny guys.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the thing. Like, the fans take them more seriously than they are.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's like us, too. I mean, we're very serious with the music and stuff, but we're just fucking idiots. Outside of it. I mean, we just couldn't be any more just silly and stupid, you know?
Yeah, that's the thing. People need to realize when it comes to music like that, like when I see you guys, I mean, I've had the pleasure of seeing a lot of your concerts. I was there at the anniversary show here in LA, or was it Anaheim? I think it was Anaheim, the Glass House.
Oh, yeah.
And we was with the Contortionists and we hung out and everybody was so lighthearted and everything. And, you know, you see it from the outside and you think it's something so serious. But that's because that's your outlet for that. You know, that's your time to be serious. That's your time to be professional and express your that side of you. But like, you know, you listen to you see people that, you know, they think that heavy metal musicians are all evil and satanic and are, you know, aggressive and violent. It's like, no, they are on stage during that time. That's when they let go. That's when they release all of that, you know?
Yeah, a great example of that was we did a tour with Cannibal Corpse years ago, and we were just kind of nervous beforehand, just like, oh man, you know, we've toured with, like, you know, some older, like, Scandinavian metal bands, and they were very, like, you know, just kept a distance, or were just kind of, like, just wild, you know, and we're like, oh man, I don't know what these guys are going to be about, and couldn't have been a more, probably just the most chill, laid back, cool guys that we've been on tour with, and we shared a lot of dressing rooms together, and you know, we throw the baseball around with Rob, their guitarist, and you know, I've exchanged emails with their bassist Alex, you know, about bass pedals and stuff, and you know, just couldn't have been nicer and more chill. And then, you know, just obviously a totally different dynamic when they go on stage. But yeah, like you said, that's not always totally indicative of who the people are that are doing it.
For sure. For sure. And I want to ask you, you guys have done some very interesting tours. I feel like booking agents have a hard time placing you guys. I saw you guys with Coheed and Cambria, and I remember, like, to me, that made sense. I mean, these both bands are progressive, and in that sense, like, they have really interesting changes in their music, time changes, and it made sense. But yeah. I was in the crowd, and I could see the torture in the eyes of these poor young ladies that were there for Coheed.
Yeah,
oh,
we.
Oh my God.
You know, that tour was great, and we had a good time with those guys in Russian Circles. But we can't help, you know, there were a few shows where it was kind of like, you know, we'd play theaters or something where they would have, like, you know, kind of like an orchestra pit, you know, like whatever's closest to the stage. Mm-hmm. And those tickets, I think, were always the most, the more expensive, you know, of the pre-sold tickets. And so it would 100% be their fans, you know, that bought these tickets, you know, to be the closest to the band, you know, when they played. And those nights were always very interesting, because our experience on stage would be totally different than what our sound guy would report, you know, in the middle. He'd be like, the show was great. And we'd be like, really? We had no, that's so strange, because you only see the first couple rows, and it's just, you know, that, yeah. They're lucky, because they have such a cool, you know, I mean, they, of course, they had songs that were on, like, MTV and maybe on the radio, but then, like, you know, a different side of them, that their fan base that was more into, like, the stories and the longer songs. Mm-hmm. And then they got, like, the comic book people, and, you know, they were, they're, like, fan bases. It's great. They're all over the place. And, you know,
I still have a picture on my phone. I saw that tour in Miami, and you guys dressed up. It was hilarious.
Yeah. Again, that was just like, just being silly. I don't know if we'd do that now. That was a perfect time. Me and Paul, you know, went to the beach, and then we went by one of the surf shops, and we saw the clothes. I don't know why we were just like, we're buying these clothes and we're going to wear them today. And then when everyone saw that we were in character and we weren't going to break it, they were kind of forced to go out and get stuff too. They were kind of like, well, we can't just let these two idiots be the only ones dressed up on stage. And it was really fun. Yeah, it's weird. The only times we've played Miami is at that theater.
At the Fillmore, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And it's always been a weird experience. Like, I think we played there with Dream Theater too.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we're always, you know, we're always end up in Fort Lauderdale or something. So that's close enough, I guess.
Sure. Yeah. I've seen you guys plenty at Revolution.
I watched a new documentary on Netflix last night about, called Screwball, about the HGH, Tony Bosch, biogenetics, situation down there with, you know, with Alex Rodriguez and,
oh yeah, yeah, yeah,
and all the baseball players, and it was all situated and took place in Miami, and it was such an interesting watch. I'm a huge baseball fan, so.
Oh, nice, nice. I'm a family friend of Puig, from the formerly of the Dodgers.
I'm an Indians fan. That's perfect. Yeah, he's our guy now. That's great.
Yeah, I'm kind of sad because I moved to LA, and we were like, you know, I was able to go to the games and
right.
and see him often, and now he's out there. I'm like, well, all right.
Yeah, he's got, you know, I was a little worried because you know, I seem to, you seem to only hear, like, when you're not following the team every day, like, the stories about him maybe being, like, kind of braggadocious, like, this big personality, and I was kind of like, oh, man, what are they doing? Why are they bringing this guy in? And then you saw, you know, how he was in Cincinnati and how, you know, his last day with the team, you know, he got in this huge brawl on field, you know, just backing up his teammates, and all the reports just being like, no, he's like a great teammate. And when he came to Cleveland, it was, you could tell that right away, and he's been hitting. So I'm into that.
Yeah. He's a good player, and he does have that over the top Cuban, like, I'm Cuban as well, so I get it, but I see, you know, the reactions from people where it's this over the top personality, kind of pro wrestler ish. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, no, I back it. It's like all of a sudden when it's on, when that energy is on your team, you're just like, yeah, let's do it. Cool.
For sure, man. Yeah, we got so close when he was in the Dodgers. I was there. Yeah. I was like, yeah, we're going to win. And then, nope.
Oh, I know. It's Cleveland was there in 2016, you know, game 7, and went to the 10th inning. Yeah, it's heartbreaking, man. When you get that far in a season, because baseball's so long, there's so many games. None of my friends at home are baseball fans. I mean, I'm also a football fan, so we engage in football, but they're just like, I don't know how you can do it for 162 games. I'm like, you know, you kind of go through waves, right? Where, like, you're really in, you know, and watching all the games when the season starts because you've been waiting. And then there's, like, a little bit of a lull and, you know, I'll tune into, like, a little bit of a game while I'm cooking, you know, in May and June. And then once the All-Star break hits, you know, you're like, I'm fucking locked in. And I've, you know, every night I'm watching, listening, like, yeah.
No, I agree. I love baseball. You know, did you ever play growing up?
I play, you know, I did backyard baseball and I played one season, but I was a soccer player. And so I was on like a travel soccer team and my dad was the manager for it. So that always kind of took precedence. But then it's funny because as I got older, like the sports that I kind of engage in now and playing are like, you know, shooting hoops and then, you know, and then baseball, you know, like hitting the ball still is like my favorite thing. And thankfully I, you know, my hand-eye coordination hasn't really gone away. Like I can still hit a ball. I can, you know, catch and probably throw better than, you know, than I could when I was younger. And I can't remember the last time I ran around on a soccer field.
Yeah, I tried soccer for a bit. I was a bigger guy, so it was kind of very taxing on my knees and my legs.
Oh, yeah.
Because, you know, not just I've put on weight the older I've gotten, but even younger, I'm a tall, big dude. You know what I mean? So it was just rough to run around like that. But baseball was always a good thing for me. And, you know, I did Little League and started trying to do it in college and ended up getting injured and not being able to do that. I used to wrestle as well, too. But baseball is one of those sports. Like, yeah, like you said, a lot of my friends don't watch and they're like, why? It's so boring. I'm like, well, I know what's going on. The subtleties, you know, that you only know if you're like a big fan or you've played it and you understand it, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, totally.
Yeah, because they want, you know, you look at football, it's much more aggressive. There's much more happening at you know, faster pace.
Yeah, I think it's also, it's just a culture shift sort of thing. You know what I mean? Like, people, like even with, you see with, like, the movies that are being made and stuff, like, it's really hard for, like, you know, the slower paced, like, art house sort of film to exist anywhere outside of, like, a streaming platform now, because people can't just, you know, turn their brains off and veg out on this thing. And that's why I love having baseball. Baseball is very important to me in sports in general, because it's the one thing I'm into that has nothing to do with creativity. You know, like I got into painting last year and that's great. I love it. You know, but then like even watching movies and reading and stuff, I'm always trying to watch and read something that's going to affect my mind in a certain way or, like, you know, keep that creative excitement going. And baseball and, like, football and basketball are the one things that I'm done. Like, the brain is off. you know, now I'm going to get lost in statistics and that's all I care about. And it's just, it's so important for like the balance.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. That's one of the most important things in life that people don't really get is being able to balance out your life. Because sometimes you'll hear, you know, don't stop, keep working, push yourself, work harder. And it's like, eventually you will burn out.
Yeah, it's hard. And I struggle with that. Like I've lived alone for the last year, and it's, there's pluses and minuses to it where it's like, you know, like last night, like 11:30 at night, you know, I've got, you know, my amp blaring and I live in the woods and there's no one around and it's just, you know, I can be loud and I can make whatever sound I want, when the inspiration strikes. But there's also just really no stopping until someone texts you and is like, hey, let's get dinner or whatever. Right. And they're like, oh fuck, wait, like what time is it? What's going on? You know, what day is it? What's going on? You know, like I've just been lost in the office for a week, you know, I don't know what's going on. So it's, you know, the balance is just important with everything in life, you know.
For sure. And, you know, your email says here, Hogweed and Fugue Records. Is that your, like, record label?
I started that when we put out the first Trioscapes record. Metal Blade was doing the CD and the digital stuff, and I really wanted to do the vinyl version of it ourselves, and they were totally cool with it. So that was really, you got to put some sort of, you know, tag, some sort of something on your record. And I did, I did the two Trioscapes albums and also we did a live session, that we would sell at shows. I pressed that on CD with like hand screen covers and stuff. Nice. And then I released a 7-inch for Orbs, and also technically our second full-length Past Life Regression was a co-release with us in Equal Vision. And then I guess the Nightmare EP that I just released last month was I guess the most recent thing that I did. And I did that on CD again with hand-pressed hand screen covers and digital download stuff. So, it's only my stuff, you know, it's just whenever I'm actually paying to, manufacture and release something. Yeah. It's my thing. It's not like it's going to be, as much as it would be fun to release stuff for friends or, you know, have artists write in. I don't have the fucking money for that. You know, it's, I'm funding my own art projects, you know, it's that sort of thing.
Yeah. So that's why I brought it up, is I wanted to ask you, you say you live in the woods and you're, yeah, you know, obviously you own property, I'm assuming. And yeah, you're busy with the band. Like,
right.
You don't have a day job at this point?
No. Yeah. So, like really, you know, our whole adult life, you know, with the guys in the band, it's been this, you know, and it used to be, you know, when I joined in 2005, you know, like that touring cycle on Alaska, Colors, and Great Misdirect, really, you know, it was like us on the road like 7-8 months out of the year, you know, that's just what we did, you know. And and it's still, you know, we still, you know, we only make money really when we're going out and playing, just thankfully, you know, as the years went on, we were able to kind of tour less, you know what I mean?
Investing some of the money you've made, like, have you invested any of, like, I'm you know, owning property is an investment, obviously.
It is. Yeah. No, I don't do like stocks or whatever. I'm honestly like kind of like an idiot when it comes to like, I'm sure that there's things that I could do to make, you know, make money go further. I'm just like, you know, this has been the thing. So it's nice because, you know, generally the things, you know, generally I'm, you know, between the buried and me allows me to kind of fund and do, you know, the other projects and the other things that I want to do, and allow myself or allow for the time to do it too, you know, when we have breaks. So
would you say the Great Misdirect was kind of like where you guys started, like you can live off of just the band situation? Like,
well, no, we were before. It's just, I think that we all just had a much lower cost of living. You know, I was living in a house with four or five other people, probably paying $200 a month, you know, like North Carolina prices. And so, I mean, it wasn't, I only bought a house 3 years ago. Blake bought a house, I think, the year after me. And, Paul and his wife have a house. You know, it was one of those things where, like, you know, I'm sure, you know, we were saving for years and years and years, you know, to get to this point. It was really, you know, we just lower cost of living in the early days. So we were able to get by just off, you know, touring and stuff. But also we were touring so much. And,
remember there was a time when you guys announced that you were like, we're going to take a break from touring because you guys are touring a lot. I remember, I don't remember if it was like after Misdirect or something like that. You guys were like, just take a pause.
Yeah, we did. We'll collectively never forget the Misdirect cycle. Cause I remember January 2010, I remember this pretty well. We left and we did a headline tour with us, Cynic and Devin Townsend. We did a full US, and when that was like a month. And when that ended, we flew to Europe and we did a support tour with, Lamb of God, and that was a month in Europe, maybe a little more, and then we flew straight from that to do Southeast Asia and Australia, then we went to Hawaii, and that took up another chunk of time, and then we went home for like 10 days, and then we went back out with Mastodon for like 5 weeks, and then we had a little bit of time at home, and then we went and did European festivals in the summer, and then we did a summer tour after that, a big festival tour, and then we came home, and then our first Orbs record was coming out, and so I did a 3 weeks, month-long tour with Orbs, like going into September, and then we broke and we wrote Parallax One, and you know, like a crazy month or two, and then recorded it, and then we were back out on the road, and it was just like it was definitely kind of like, I think, you know, I never want to talk down on a record because, you know, someone could love that record or whatever, but that, you know, it was not an inspired time writing that EP. It just seemed like we could have used a couple months away.
Yeah.
From just the band, just to like accumulate stuff. We just weren't home to work on stuff or write or anything. And, so then it was, you know, during that touring cycle on that album, on the Parallax One EP, that I started Trioscapes, and and for me, I felt like that was like a shot in the arm for myself, where it was like totally different energy, totally different set of people, and then when we started writing Parallax Two, it was kind of like, okay, now we're really moving forward, and that felt great. But yeah, again, we were talking about the balance, and it's like we could, you know, we've had the conversations where we're like, I mean, we could stay out on the road for, you know, 10 months and make a lot more money, but it's like at this, you know, Tommy's got a kid, a couple of the other guys are married. It's, you know, no one wants to be on the road for 10 months or whatever.
Yeah. You need a little break.
So, oh my God. So, you know, I feel like we're at a really, comfy touring pace right now. And I mean, you know, the first half of this year was pretty light with a couple tours, and, you know, we're going to Europe for like 3 weeks coming up here, and then we're home for like a month. And then, we're going out with Chon for almost 2 months. It's probably the longest American tour we've done in just years. I mean, it's something like 49. It's either 49 shows or 49 days, which is a lot.
Yeah.
But that would be a good way to wrap up, and then we'll disappear a little bit and you know, come back next year. I think we're going to some other territories that we haven't done on this album. So that'll be nice.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, you guys have, you know, what it seems to me, like, with Paul and Dusty, like, the shredding that's happening with the notes, like, you guys explore so many different notes and so many different areas. Like, it's got to be difficult to, A, remember all of that, and then, B, not burn yourself out when you're writing something new so that it doesn't sound like, you know, you want to keep it fresh. You don't want to be like, oh, that sounds like that other song, or, you know what I mean? Like, you're not rehashing anything.
That's an easy thing to do, is to not, you know, is to move forward and rehash, because it's just, you know, your ears are just attuned to something different, you know, every time you come in. But yeah, as far as like remembering stuff, you know, it kicks in pretty quick when you're relearning songs, and then, you know, just rehearsing at home, because we only get up in the practice space for like a day before a tour. And play the songs together, and like, yeah, we know them. Let's go. Okay. But we definitely only know those songs, you know, if we were in a situation where we're forced to play any other song, it would it'd be very taxing, pretty mentally, you know, because it's just, you know, I kind of know what I know for a tour, and then get home and dump that. You know, put some new material in from whatever I'm working on, whatever I'm writing, and then have to dump that, and then put in whatever I'm squeezing in for the next tour. So I have a feeling that on this next run we do in Europe, that we will definitely be at max capacity with 2 hours of material, and that'll be a lot.
Yeah, fans don't understand that aspect of it. Like, you'll get shows sometimes where the fans are yelling stuff out, play this song, or, you know, hey, play All Bodies. It's like, dude, we don't, I don't remember that.
Yeah, it's all good well, too, when it's like a 3-minute long song, and not when it's, 12 minutes of just.
Yeah. Play White Walls when, like, you don't even have it in your set list. It's like, oh, God, what do you mean?
No, exactly. Yeah. And that's, you know, pushing a 15-minute long song or something. It's a lot. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, dude, I have to ask you one last thing before we wrap this up, because it's, you know, we're almost at an hour. And I know my vegan friends will be very upset if I don't ask you about it. But how are you feeling about, you know, this change? I've been noticing, like, you look at fast food restaurants, like Burger King's got their Impossible Whopper now, and Del Taco out here in L.A. has got, like, Beyond Tacos.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that? Do you feel that, you know, it's a good thing? Do you think that the quality might not be up to par with, like, if you were to just, you know, it's a fast food place?
Right. No, you know, we went and it was the first night of preseason football for the Carolina Panthers, the night that the burger was released at Burger King. So we had planned to have just, like, a gross fast food night and try it. just kind of want it for me. It was definitely one and done. Like, I just want to try this, and then, you know, then it'll be saved for if we're at an airport or something. You know, it was good, you know, and I've had the Impossible Burger at a lot of different places. What I think is great about it is that there's a lot of people who haven't tried a veggie burger, and are hearing, you know, a lot, like even my stepdad, you know, heard a lot about the Impossible Burger and, you know, the taste and everything that's gone into it. And I feel like, you know, this is an opportunity for maybe someone new to try a plant-based product and not be, you know, totally scared off or, I don't know, grossed out by it. I don't know if you've had the Impossible Burger, but you can't be grossed out by it. I mean,
I hear you. I hear you, because I used to be vegan for a little bit, and then kind of been trying to get that back into my life. But, you know, back before there was Beyond and before there was Impossible, veggie patties were kind of gross. They were just, like, to me anyway, they had no flavor. It was kind of spongy.
Oh, the darkest. We were talking about this recently. That the darkest thing that I could think of eating from the past was a microwaved Boca burger. And I've definitely done it. And yeah, it's just not great, but you know, it was what it was. And so that's the thing for like me and a lot of my friends, where it's like, you know, I've been vegan for almost 20 years. And like, there was just a lot of time of not having, you know, a good cheese substitute, or, you know, the meat substitutes that there are now, or them being as readily available. And it's funny, because now that they are readily available with like the Beyond stuff in the stores and
Daiya,
Violife, all these companies, that it's funny because it's like now they're there and it's great, but I don't buy them often. You know, it's kind of funny. I'm totally glad that the accessibility is there, especially for younger vegans, for people that just want to, I don't know, shake it up. You know, like if my mom goes to the grocery store and she's like, oh, well, I'll buy the veggie sausages today, I'll try that out. Of course it's great. And, there's no disadvantage to it. You know, the one disadvantage with the impossible stuff, I think for a second, I think hopefully it's working itself out, was that, a lot of the local places that had the Impossible Burger, because they only sell to restaurants, didn't have it because, you know, it was going to Qdoba and Burger King. But I've seen even at the places in Greensboro where I live that they now have the burger back in stock again. So it's one of those things where it's like, yeah, it, you know, it's great that it's everywhere at, you know, White Castle, Burger King, whatever. But you want to make sure that the local places have it too, because I'm more likely to get that burger at one of those places than go to Burger King again.
For sure, for sure. Yeah, I appreciate that it's more accessible, because that was one of my biggest problems, was just how expensive it can be to you know, make your own stuff and go to farmers markets and get the veggies and all of that. And, you know, sometimes, like, you just don't have the budget, or, you know, financial situations put a strain on it, and it can be very difficult. And they make it so easy for you to just go get a dollar freaking, you know, beef taco somewhere.
I got to try them. I haven't been able to try them out there yet.
Yeah. No, the Beyond ones. Yeah, they're all right. I mean, the texture is off. The flavor's fine. It's just, the texture feels a little mushy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it's a little weird, but
I've been eating Veggie Works burritos anyways for years, so it's, you know, now, worst case. No, I was saying worst case, if I'm at a Del Taco, you know, I'll just go Veggie Works and fries. No sour cream, no cheese.
Nice. Are you a vegan for animal reasons? Like you love animals,
yeah.
Or is it something else? Okay.
No, yeah, it was just that. You know, it's turned into, you know, that, but, you know, just like with, I think with most people, as you get a little bit older, you try to eat healthier too. So it's like, it was one thing to not eat that and then realize that you can still eat really shitty, you know, and just, you know, there's other things that will, you know, destroy you. And so it's, you know, as time goes on, you know, I felt like I was just getting into eating healthier as well. But no, it was definitely because of the animals.
That's awesome, man. Yeah, I love, you know, I'm not vegan right now, but I have been substituting things little by little, mostly for health reasons.
Like
I had to start substituting dairy because my body couldn't take it anymore.
Right.
So I've been using a lot of the Daiya products, and like Trader Joe's has a decent cheese, soy shredded cheese thing that I can.
Yeah.
And you know, little by little, I haven't really been eating a lot of red meat. Last time I did, I got sick. So it's just, you know, I've been trying to make those changes. And like I did raw vegan for 2 years. And
oh, wow.
Yeah, it was because I was with a lady and she was into it, and we just did it, you know, we did it together, and it was awesome. But I also got sick from that. You know what I mean? It was weird. I wasn't getting enough, I guess, nutrients or protein or vitamins. I don't know what it was, but I ended up getting sick as well. So I'm just trying to find that balance for myself. But But you know, the animal thing has been a big concern for me because I love animals. I used to have like a zoo almost at home. I had all kinds of, you know, exotic animals, and I would build habitats for them so they could live in there. And is that something that you've wanted to do since you live in the woods? Like, have you thought about maybe building out like a habitat for some animals for yourself? Like rescue animals?
You know, I'm a big dog guy, but it's, you know, living alone and traveling so much. It's such
It's hard to keep track and keep, you know, maintain them for sure.
So hopefully, hopefully someday, I mean, you know, I'm hopeful I'd be in a position where I can adopt, you know, a pup friend again. But, you know, for right now, I just, you know, for right now, I'm the go-to dog sitter for friends. And that's fun.
Nice. Well, hey, dude, I really appreciate your time. Thank you so much for, you know, speaking about all the things you spoke about and keeping us up to date with the music. I know you said you're looking at 2020 for possible new music for BTBAM.
Mm-hmm.
You got the Nightmare Scenario coming out soon. Or we're not, the EP's out, but the full length.
The full length, yeah. I'm definitely going to get started recording this year. That has to happen.
Nice. So if anybody wants to keep track of this stuff, where would they go? What's the best like social media to keep track of what you're doing with Nightmare Scenario?
Yeah, maybe you know, Instagram or Twitter. Dan Briggs Music is my Instagram, and Dan Briggs X is my Twitter.
Nice. Cool, man. And yeah, and anybody that's listening, you know, the tour with Chon and Intervals is coming up as well. So catch them on the road. And I'm hoping you guys have a Southern California date during that.
Oh, my God. Well, because Chon is from out there, there's like 6 shows out there. It's insane. We both, for a band on the East Coast, you know, it's annoying because it both starts and ends out there. But it's I'm sure that the shows will be great because they're out there from out there. So, yeah. There's a lot.
I'd love to connect once, if you guys are out here, like in LA or Anaheim or something like that, in Southern. I LA is annoying because there's so many labels and people that want to get on the guest list and
everything. Just, our label, our management, and our booking agent are out there. Plus, you know, it's just a place that people from all walks of life end up moving to. So it's like, you get hit up by someone and you're like, I thought you were in, you know, Ohio. And they're like, oh, yeah, I live in LA now. And you're like, oh, well, great. Okay. I guess I'll see you too.
Well, I hope to, hopefully there's an Anaheim show or somewhere outside of LA so we can hang out and connect. But yeah, I appreciate your time, dude. Thanks again.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks, man.
All right. Cheers.
You can shield you from